Good afternoon. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome Mr. Amarjit Chopra, a distinguished chartered accountant. I think I had briefly mentioned to you my association with him earlier, but let me once again repeat. Both of us were together on the board of Bank of Baroda, and I used to be amazed at his not just knowledge, but simplicity and very succinct observations whenever any issue related to accounting or finance came. His wisdom was very widely used by the bank for a long time. He was also chairman of our audit committee. Yes, and of course, he is a well-known chartered accountant outside. My association with him was limited only to the Bank of Baroda related issues. It was a great pleasure working with him during those years, and we came quite close. So when this program was being formulated, and we had a first meeting here with Bakshi was here, and I think Mr. Banka was here, and we were wondering who all people should come from the association, and I mentioned his name. Then they, of course, they said he was the past president of the association, so it would be a pleasure. But we are not very sure whether he will be able to find time from his busy schedule. So I took the liberty of calling him one day and requesting him. And he was so kind to say that, well, Patak, if you are calling, I'll definitely come. So I'm very thankful to you, sir, for sparing your time. I know how busy he is. He will be spending only a short while with you, but please use this opportunity to ask any questions or any doubts that you have. Like the other faculty colleagues, he is also very keen that proper practices are established and accepted and utilized by all educational institutions. And as I said the first day, this is only a beginning. I would like each one of you to go back, convince your directors and others that your institution should become a center for subsequent training programs. And with Bakshi ji and our mission director, Praveen Prakash, I will work to conduct such future training programs from IIT Bombay to thousands of our other colleagues. So in that sense, you are the pioneering people. We'll of course make available all the recorded sessions for not only your benefit, but for the benefit of others. I would have personally liked to sit here and listen to him at least partly, because it's a long time that I have heard him speaking in those board meetings. But unfortunately, I have to go out immediately after this. So I told Mr. Bakshiji that whatever happens, I will come here. I'll have the privilege of introducing him, and then I will take your leave. So friends, let's welcome with a big applause Mr. Amarjit. And Amarjit ji, once again, thank you for accepting our invitation.
My pleasure, sir.
All yours, sir.
My pleasure. Good afternoon, friends. It's a real privilege to be amongst you this afternoon. There are two topics which have been assigned to me. One is with regard to the segmental reporting, that is AS-17. And the other one is with regard to the related party disclosures. We call them accounting standards, but there is no accounting in them. Let me be very clear about it. Both these standards are disclosure standards. Most of the time the questions have been asked that why do we require these kind of standards and why should we call them accounting standards at all? Because even if you go to AS-20, that is with regard to the EPS, or you go to the discontinuing operations, that's the AS-24, these are all disclosure standards. It has nothing to do so far as the accounting part is concerned. Even if you look at it internationally from that angle, you will find earlier they used to call it IAS, International Accounting Standard. They no more call it International Accounting Standards, they call it International Financial Reporting Standards. Because the disclosures are part of the financial reporting. So if you really ask me, these two are part of the financial reporting. And these two standards can improve upon your understanding, the understanding of any reader of the financial statements, to a very, very large extent, to a great extent. But then at the same time, I wonder what kind of an applicability it can have to the educational institutions like yours. Because wherever the government institutions are there, where is the question of the related party? But I will deal with that also to some extent. But in any case, understanding of any accounting standard is better. And my humble request to you will be, when we leave this hall, you shouldn't leave with any kind of a doubt. Anything that you want to ask, any number of questions that you want to ask, please ask. Rather, I will feel pleased if at any point of time I can tell you that I will get back to you tomorrow on the mail. That would be the test of your questions if you really ask me. The first standard is the segmental reporting that I am going to do. That's the AS-17. Now, number one, this is not a standard which is applicable to all the enterprises. No. It is applicable primarily to level one entities, if you ask me. And when we talk of the level one entities, you must have already discussed it in the earlier session somewhere or the other. If you are dealing with the accounts of any entity which has its equity or debt listed either in India or abroad, or which has the plan by way of a board resolution already that they are going to get it listed in India or abroad, not only equity, even the debt, if the debentures are really issued and those are listed, bonds are issued and those are listed, or it's a case of a bank, including a cooperative bank, if it's an insurance company from that angle, in that case also this is then, it becomes mandatorily applicable. Or if it's an enterprise, you could have educational institutions here, where the catch would lie. If your turnover exceeds 50 crores, or if your borrowings exceed 10 crores, in that particular case, it automatically becomes applicable to you, irrespective of the fact whether you belong to a listed category or not, you are a bank or not, you are an insurance company or not, you are a mutual fund or not. In that, if your turnover is beyond a particular level, your borrowings are beyond a particular level, so far as the borrowings are concerned, it can be in the current year itself. But so far as the turnover is concerned, it has to be in the last audited financial statements, basically. And to that also I will be coming. But this turnover will not include the other income. What I am trying to say so is, suppose you have the gross receipts by way of the educational receipts, you have the tuition fees, you have the sports fees, you have everything. That is covered. But when it comes to interest on the bank deposits, that is not covered by this. That be very clear. So far as your receipts on account of educational receipts are concerned, the tuition fees are concerned, the sports fees are concerned, any other receipt which is concerned, which is primarily on account of the educational activity, that will be covered. But if you have, suppose you sold out some scrap, or you have the bank interest coming in because of the various deposits that you have made, that will not be considered to be a part of your turnover for the purpose of this 50 crore limit under those circumstances. That you will have to exclude. Now, the paramount question, and where I will like to draw your kind attention, is why this standard at all? Believe me, this standard has tremendous advantage to understand the functioning of an enterprise for the purpose of the decision making, for the purpose of a better understanding over the any enterprise or the educational institution from that angle. And I can tell you, you might agree that we are all single segment institutions. We are all, we can say that we are only dealing with the education, and since we are dealing with the education, I have only one segment and I don't have any other segment, but I will be able to say something else at a later point of time. Look at the case of one of the biggest groups in this country, I am not naming that. If you look at its total profitability, out of that 80 to 85% of the profitability comes out of a product on the packet of which is written cigarette smoking is injurious to health. And all these hotels, gigantic institutions that they have set up, the gigantic projects that they have set up, these are not giving them the profits, if you really ask me. The real profit comes to them from the tobacco activity. And on that particular package is written, cigarette smoking is injurious to health. Now if I have to go to a bank, if I have to go to the shareholder, and I say I want to expand my activity with regard to the hotel industry, they will say, hold on, to us hotel industry is not very pertinent. We are more willing to finance you for the tobacco activity. Whereas if you look from the social perspective, probably you don't know which one day one of the prime ministers or one of the chief ministers can get up and say, we ban the tobacco products. After all, it happened in Haryana a few years back that one of the chief ministers got up and said that I want to ban the liquor. Though the liquor was more available at that time, rather it was available at your home rather than going to the shops. That was the kind of the situation. But the fact remains that this can be one of these situations. Another example that I can give you is there was one company which is also engaged both in the development of the software for educational institutions, for the not only educational institutions alone, for the parties, accounting software, all other kind of softwares. But they are also into the education. Now if you look at their accounts, their position is that both of these segments, there's one segment is the educational segment, the other segment is the technical segment, and the technological segment is dealing with the development of the software. But if you look at both these segments are showing losses. The company is still showing profits. Now, one of the questions can be asked is, how is it possible? If you look at their net profit is net profit. It is not a loss. But if you ask for the information under the segmental reporting, both the technological segment as well as the educational segment is showing losses. Their main income is coming from what they have invested in the subsidiaries by way of a dividend, or what they have invested in the banks, it is coming by way of the interest, or what they are earning by way of certain commission income, etc., etc. I don't think that any shareholder invests in the company for that particular purpose. No shareholder invests in the company for that particular purpose. The shareholder invests in the company for the purpose of, and it is a listed entity, mind it. The shareholders at the time when the prospectus came in, the shareholders have invested in this particular company for the purpose that their money, their funds will be utilized either for the technological developments or for the purpose of the educational. But if you look at the segmental disclosures, it is absolutely the reverse way around. So what I am trying to tell you is, at times, this can be a very, very important information from the educational institution's perspective. It is very much possible that you run run-of-the-mill courses. You are running graduation courses, you are running post-graduation courses. But suppose you run the specialized courses. And you will agree with me, in the specialized courses, the elasticity of the demand is absolutely different from the run-of-the-mill courses. Not only that, probably the profitability levels are different in the specialized courses. There you charge on a different pattern. And in the run-of-the-mill courses, you charge on a different pattern altogether. And if you go to the definition of the segments, you will find the definition talking of different risks and returns. The product or services might be the same, but even if they have the different risks and returns, probably this could be considered to be a different business segment altogether. I'm talking from your perspective. It is very, very, very much possible that when you run the specialized courses, one of your auditors can come turn around and say, I do not agree that you are a single segment company and you continue to say, we only are dealing with the education, so we'll not do anything else. This is one of the debates that we have in the institute ourselves also. Whether we can keep on saying that whatever we do with regard to the student activity and the member activity is the same or not. To my mind, student activity is different from the member activity, if you ask me. We should have two different segments rather than one segment. So what I'm trying to explain you before I really get into the standard is, what is the objective of the standard? If you find that our specialized courses itself are not running into the profits, where is the question of running those? And why should I run those? Unless the specialized courses run into the profits, they show segmentally profit into those particular segments, I think you will like to say that I want to discontinue so far as the specialized courses are concerned. This is probably the hallmark so far as this particular accounting standard is concerned. And then you can have different educational institutions where you are multiple locations, you are having multiple locations rather than having one location. Now, if you are having location of an education, you may not have, but I am telling you, one, most of the private sector educational institutions today have, they have not only presence in India, they have the presence abroad also, for that matter. Now, the moment you have the presence abroad, you get into the geographical segments also. Because there the risk of the foreign currency is different from the risk of the local currency. The perception, the fee structure, the profitability levels, the returns are absolutely different from what you are earning in the local currency for that particular matter. So what I am trying to explain you is, it is not that it is totally not applicable to you. You may have certain areas in which you can say, probably this particular standard is also of some kind of an interest to you, and you need to understand how to really reach what is a reportable segment and what is not a reportable segment for that, from that angle. And if it is a reportable segment, what all you are going to report in that reportable segment? All those things need to be taken care of. Any questions so far?
No.
Yeah.
They are running many courses outside India.
Yeah. So definitely you will have a position wherein you can say that one is domestic and the other is international.
International.
Yes. You will have two different segments altogether. Take the case of Air India. I'm giving you a parallel. It may not be educational institution, but I'm giving you the parallel case. Or take the case of any airline. When you run an airline which is domestic, your risk levels are different.
Yes.
When you start running it internationally, your tariff structure changes, your risk changes, your foreign currency risk changes, everything undergoes a change. So those become two different segments. And these are called two different business segments from that angle.
Yes, business segment.
But in the case of IGNU, it could be geographical segments also. That can be the difference. To that I will come little later.
Okay. There are web-based courses also. There are web-based courses.
Yeah.
Online courses which are there.
Yeah.
Their geographical boundaries are not there.
Yeah.
So in which segment? It may be domestic, it may be international, both.
I think you have raised a very, very pertinent point, if you really ask me. Now, the moment you have the web-based, you see, you think of a particular organization which is running a normal trading business and which is running online business. There is absolutely no boundary. The risks could also be different because there are the IT risks, the payment risks. You have to really analyze all those. So probably you can treat those as two different business segments altogether. There's no doubt in my mind. If I am in your place, I will definitely treat them as two business segments. I have been advocating, even to the extent it may seem to be too far-fetched if you ask me, when this standard came in, as I had the privilege of heading even the accounting standard board of the institute for 2 years, I have been of the view, if I am a car manufacturing company and I am manufacturing, one is Maruti 800 and the other is in the upper segment of 20 lakhs, I think these are two different business segments to my mind. In one, if you increase the price slightly, it doesn't make much of the difference. People will still continue to buy Maruti 800. In the other segment, if you raise the price slightly, probably people go out of it. So, to my mind, so one of the ways the Maruti could have said is that we are only car manufacturing. We are only dealing into the automobiles. And that's the end of it. In my view, it is altogether different. So probably it can be a different segment from that angle.
I have another question, sir. Suppose one activity is there of any education or say examination, which is conducted in India also, and there are centers abroad also. Same examination, activity is one only. Now segments are two.
If you treat your foreign courses separate.
No, I'm talking about one examination.
Then it is not a separate segment. Let me be very clear.
We have examination.
You have to have the business segment different. You see, when I talk of the business segment, it is the same activity. Whether you treat as two activities or one activity, examination is a subset of the entire process.
Okay.
But whether your that course can be treated as two activities or not, my answer is no.
It is only one.
It is only examination that you are conducting outside.
Some centers are abroad.
No, but that doesn't make it two activities. Curriculum is the same. That's what I am saying. The person is paying the same level, and the risks and returns are virtually the same. There is hardly any difference. Now, from that angle, we are having our chapters abroad as an institute, but we don't treat it as a separate segment under any circumstances.
Because clientele might also be Indians residing abroad.
No, they are probably, if you are an exporter and you are also dealing locally, you have two different segments.
Definitely.
One is the export segment and the other is the domestic sales segment. Because your customers are different, and there, the moment you get into the foreign currency part altogether as a customer, in that case, the risk, if you have looked at the Indian scenario in the recent past, there are companies which have booked losses, derivative losses of 400 to 1,000 crore rupees in 1 year.
Because
whereas in local currency, you have not booked any loss.
So, suppose there is a company, so then EU, exporter, and it is permitted to sell 75% of its goods abroad.
25% they can sell it in Indian market. Mm. So, the segments are
different. You can treat it. I can tell you that whatever is your domestic product, you see, EOU under the law is permitted to sell specified percentage of the product locally. But your local sale is different from your export sale.
Again, two segments.
So, two segments.
Departments will be separate segments for an institute, or a courses will be separate?
No, it is not a department. These are the courses. These are the courses which have to be. You see, what is important is that if you are running different courses altogether, in the same department, you might be running two different courses. So, if you are running these different courses under the same department, where the risks and returns are altogether different, the product is different, the customers are different, in that particular case, it becomes a different business segment.
Sir, in some universities, regular education
and if you are having normal physical teaching and distance learning education, these are two different segments, very clearly. Very, very clearly. Because your entire process changes. Your customers change. Basically, if you look at it, the student pattern undergoes a change. The students who are opting for the distance learning are different class compared to the people who opt for the physical teaching.
Can you please repeat your reply regarding courses and department segregation?
You see, if you are running, say, science education, You are running commerce education, but you can say we are educational institution for that angle. So it could be construed as a single segment enterprise or as an institution. But if you have presence abroad, or say one of the, say commerce, I can talk of commerce department, they run, besides running the courses on BCom or MCom, they also run on export management as a separate course. And there the fee levels are absolutely different. You charge maybe to somebody 20,000, 30,000, 40,000, the modus operandi is different. That could be construed as a different segment, not that one is a science department, another is a commerce department, so these will be considered as a different segment. That is not going to happen.
Okay, that means the courses are going to be at that course point.
Courses, the product. Okay. It is the product which is more important. When I go to the definition of the segment, business segment, you will find it is referring to any product or service which is identifiable in any case. And if you can come to a product that come to a situation where the process of production, etc., is the same, it is one segment. If the channels of distribution can be different, this can be a different segment altogether from that angle. Like I was talking about exports basically. Now in export, you will have absolutely different modus operandi so far as selling part is concerned compared to the other part. And when you go to the geographical segments, there it is the economic environment which is going to be different. Now if you are exporting, within even that export, I can tell you, we have a situation, if I was exporting to Libya, there is a Russian bloc, there is a European bloc, and there is an American bloc. These three different blocks could be considered as three different segments. Because the risks of the currency in all the three different blocks are going to be different. The political environment in all the three blocks is going to be absolutely different. So that is where it matters ultimately.
We are having separate community college.
Separate?
Community colleges.
Community colleges.
Community colleges, where constituent colleges will be there, which deals with some vocational courses.
No, vocational courses and run of the mill. Yeah, these can be two different segments altogether.
Yeah.
I will try to encourage you to show more segments, if you really ask me. Because as a management, you will be better placed to take decisions. If you are able to identify different segments, bring out segment results, segment assets, segment liabilities differently, then you can take a better decision whether to continue with it or to discontinue the same.
In technological institute, we have BTech, MTech, PhD.
Technological institute?
IIT. We have BTech, MTech, PhD, MBA.
PhD could be considered to be different, but not the BTech or MTech. You see, if I am running BCom or MCom, it is more or less the same. MBA. But PhD is something different.
And MBA.
MBA could also be the same. You see, if you run BBA and MBA, to my mind, it is more or less the same. To my mind, still it is the same. But PhD is altogether a different preposition.
Our fee structure is quite different for MBA.
No, again, I am coming to, it is not merely the fee structure. Because in BCom, you could be charging maybe 1,000 rupees, and in MCom, you could be charging 1,500 rupees. It doesn't mean that these are two different segments.
But when there is a vast difference between the fees,
the product, the customer are more or less the same. But wherever the products are more or less different, now PhD is absolutely a different product. It is not the same product. There, the emphasis is not on a degree. The emphasis on the research part, basically the research findings, and getting into the doctorate part thereof, and then coming out with a particular document. And the fee levels are absolutely different. Rather, some of the people who are doing doctorate may be getting the stipend also, may be getting some kind of a scholarship. So there the entire preposition is different compared to the normal courses.
Sir, most of the educational institutions, apart from doing education, they are involved in research and development, getting projects, and giving consultancies, all should be different?
That is altogether a different project. That is definitely a different segment. You see, if as an institute, I personally tell you, we produce chartered accountants, but on the other side of it, if we undertake some project for conversion from single entry to double entry, it is definitely a different segment. There is no doubt in my mind. Project is different, and teaching is altogether different. These are absolutely different segments. There is no doubt.
So, sir, certain services in universities.
It's like, very difficult to. Yeah, yes. Please.
Universities normally have a publication unit. Universities have a sophisticated analytical unit. So, these are normally considered auxiliary services. So, will these, under this segment reporting, will these be treated as separate segments?
To me, probably no, though I have been encouraging. If as a university I am supposed to produce some kind of books for the students, I will still treat it as a part of the educational system. And I will, of course, I may show it in the profit and loss account differently, the purchase material and the sale material in respect thereof, but I will still treat it to be the same segment. See, there are two kind of things which you have to be very clear about. One is when you have different segments, and one is, and that segment disclosure has to come by way of the AS-17, or now even certain disclosures would be required by the Companies Act, wherever it is a company. Or alternatively, you will be disclosing certain things in the profit and loss account. Now, if you are receiving tuition fee, it is a normal receipt. But if you sell off some of your fixed assets and you make a profit out of that, that profit has to be shown in the profit and loss account, but it does not become a different segment. Similarly, when as an educational institution I develop certain literature and I sell it and I charge for it, probably it is not a different segment, but I will be showing it differently, sale of the literature. So to that extent, that will prevail.
In case of consultancy, we are receiving as tuition fee as well as consultancy fee. But then
I have already answered that question. If you are undertaking consultancy along with the educational part,
yes,
then it is a different segment.
Sir, I have a different question. Hello. Suppose I have a different segment.
You have a
different segment.
Yeah.
Then I need to prepare the books of accounts.
Books of accounts remain the same, please, no difference. As I said, it is not an accounting issue. This entire accounting standard is not an accounting issue. It is a disclosure issue. What you are supposed to do later on is to find out which are the reportable segments. Let me complete the standard. At that time, I will be able to answer your question. But I am just, you have preempted me. So I will answer it right now slightly in a very brief manner. You can be sure about it that in those circumstances, you will have segments, different segments, but those different segments, you can have a memoranda record if you want to maintain, but not different books of accounts. Books of account remain the same. Executive development programs and MBA, these are two different segments. Let's be very clear about it. There is no doubt about it. But what is important to be understood there is that the moment you start receiving fee for the MDP programs, you will show it as MDP receipts, and all the expenses linked there will, you will debit to that, and you will be able to reach the profitability in respect thereof. The only difference will be that in the books of accounts, you will have direct expenses and direct incomes. Whereas when you come to the segmental reporting, you will have to identify their segmental assets and segmental liabilities, and also your whole overall infrastructure probably which has been allocated even for the MDP program. Please try to appreciate one thing. It is not only the teacher whom you pay, who is really getting paid for it. Even certain peons, even certain other staff is there. He may not be rendering entire service for the MDP program, but part of his time might have it gone there. So on a reasonable basis, you will attribute to that and show as a part of the segmental information. To that I will come later. Okay.
May I ask you one question, sir?
Please.
Will there be any impact on balance sheet for this AS-17?
No. No impact on the balance sheet. No impact on the profit and loss account. It is only an additional disclosure. It is only from the perspective that the reader, more than the reader, your own management. I will come to that particular part also. We like to find out which segment is contributing and which segment is not contributing. And any segment which is not contributing, why to continue with that? As simple as that. See, ultimately, Maruti 800 has been phased out, if you ask me. Why? There should be a reason. Once Maruti came to a conclusion that probably this segment is not giving me the profit, enough profit, in terms of the resources that I have deployed, probably they have discontinued with it. So that's how it happens. Anyone else? But I am really delighted by the number of the questions which have come in. I never thought that on segmental reporting in educational institutions, though so many questions can come in.
Yes, sir. So I understand that the universities, most of them are grantee universities.
Are?
Salaries. Most of the central universities are grantee universities. We depend on grants from the government.
Grants, okay.
So, but within the university, there are expenses which are outside the grants. They're like the award funds, endowment funds we call, which are instituted by any of the prominent citizen or any of a prominent instituted to give an award to any student. So these are outside the grants. So these are reported separately.
But this then is not segmental part.
These are
it is a fund. Please try to appreciate.
So anything which is not from the grants are reported separately.
I'm preempting your question.
And then then there are the university also. Yes, all the departments of the university depends on grants.
I fully concur.
But within them, they run self-financing courses also. So these self-financing courses also are reported separately, but finally they amalgamate in the same balance
both
sheet.
Both courses I have already said.
Yes.
If you feel that these are specialized courses.
Self-financing.
Which have different takers from the normal courses that you run, probably you can treat those as different segments.
Segments,
I've
yes.
Already
so
said
we
it.
Reported.
I've
I
already
think
said
that reporting
it.
Is correct.
Yeah, I've already said.
Yes, sir.
But so far as the other part is concerned that you talked of, suppose I receive sports grant from the student itself. I charge the sports
no,
fee.
So those comes in the fees, sir. Those are fees. It is included in the fees. The fees is the income of the university, not the income of that particular self-financing course.
So, absolutely. In that, whatever you receive against that, that will be considered to be your segmental revenue. And whatever you expend against that will be considered to be your segmental expenditure. But in addition thereto, you will still have certain expenditure which you will have to allocate to those expenses.
Yes, yes.
To courses, to reach the correct segment result.
We have nursery to PhD.
You have?
Nursery to PhD.
Nursery to PhD.
Yeah.
Okay.
We have art and culture, sculpture department, we have science, we have literature, we have music, B.Ed and A.Med. How will segregate? Segment how will be there? I will report.
Yeah, I think your question is the toughest of the lot that I have got so far. You see, the point that you have raised is, you have the music section, You have the science section, you have the commerce section. I still repeat, probably to my mind, these may not be different segments. These will still be a part of my educational segment. Because the takers are the normal ones. But yes, if music is absolutely a specialized course that you are running, and there is no degree that you award for that, virtually it is a certificate course, in that you may be able to treat it as a different segment altogether. But how to reach that segment result, I will be able to come only when I proceed. Because I have to tell you how to reach that segment result. I'm not able to proceed on that.
No, sir. No, not how to reach the segmental report. How I'll segregate it. Segment, how I'll show it. What, in which segment it will come. That I'm asking.
I'll definitely come to that when I come to the allocation part.
Okay.
But allow me to proceed.
No, sir, not allocation. Whether nursery will separate segment, nursery and masters.
Nursery and?
Sir, we have nursery, we have secondary, we have higher secondary.
Okay. What you can do is, you can have nursery as one, primary as another one, secondary as another one, and then the other one. You can have those kind of segments if you like. It satisfies? Okay, can we move on? Okay.